Hi everyone. My name is Imran. I am going to yeah, so I'd like to put a few things related to the agnosticism in the cloud that we deploy on today. So one of the biggest challenges that anyone has today is lack of standardization and burning questions on multi-cloud optimizations and so on, as Shiraz has introduced to the conference. So I'd like to take on the same angle over here. And some of the biggest concerns that we have today in 2018 are the same things which were there in 1998 as well. So earlier it was there with desktops, local servers, and so on. And today this has manifested on the cloud itself. So all the communities those days were more concerned about freedom of open source movements and so on. Now this has translated into similar challenges on the cloud. So, of course, for everything there is a study, and there is a study for this. Gartner says that the lack of standards is like a very, very pressing challenge for most people. And there is a huge amount of challenge for customers who perceive a cloud lock-in similar to the vendor lock-ins of the 90s, where people migrate between platforms and so on. So, people are talking about similar challenges in cloud deployment. So with that as a baseline, so let's get started. So this is again a simple slide that I wanted to explain to you on why infrastructure could be better served in a cloud-agnostic manner. So typically what happens is whenever you go for cloud-native services, you are paying for the software, not for the infrastructure. So that's a fundamental change in paradigm in what you are paying for. Typically we are so used to paying for infrastructure on the cloud. Now that has gone a transformation, and with cloud-native services, you are essentially paying for software being served in a SaaS model for you. For example, your database is a service, your queue is a service, your whatever is a service, right? So that essentially has an impact on the entire pricing mechanism, because pricing for software is non-deterministic, right? It's what product managers come up with on their own, right? Whereas pricing for infrastructure can be predictable and deterministic. That's the fundamental difference in how we build infrastructure for the cloud in today's age. Now, if you have to look at a typical challenges on why people want to go cloud native, is the same old challenges: the lack of personal, lack of documentation, lack of this, lack of that. Now, what has happened is like then obviously like when product managers dream of their SaaS offerings, there is obviously a cost overrun to that. Now, if you do a mix and match and hybridization of this infrastructure, you could still do some of the components, let's say, which cannot be replaceable, like an SQS, which you cannot easily replace unless you do some of your own queue management. So unless you do that, you cannot easily transfer. So let's say 20% or 20 rupees of your infrastructure can be on cloud native, your DynamoDBs and Lambdas, which cannot be easily replaced to, let's say, OpenDisk and Mongo's and so on, and the rest of it could be your complete cloud agnostic infra, which has got nothing to do with it. And it's not to say that cloud agnostic means like you move out of the cloud, right? You can still be on with whatever clouds that you are running on, any of the top 3 or the top 5 cloud service providers. But what we are tracking for here is a cloud agnostic paradigm over here, where nothing is dependent on the native services of the cloud, and you can do a multi-cloud deployment and migrate your workloads between public clouds very easy. That's what we are asking for. So again, with that setup, you typically need a bit more typical system admin and DevOps effort than you would do in a typical cloud native service. But the challenge in cloud native service is that you are essentially learning one particular platform, which is like a data skill in use. So again, this is more of a myth breaker slide. There's nothing here that is very technical, but the point I'm trying to make is like this is again like an advocacy of the free open source thing 2 years back. All we are saying is for every native service, there exists an alternative in the cloud agnostic space, right? Where you can do your own setups and you can be completely free to migrate your workloads anywhere. So this is just an illustrative slide. There are multiple other tools available for doing the same thing. Now, let's talk about scale then, so, which is the first thing we want to discuss today. And one of the fundamental challenges to scaling is to know when to scale. And you cannot scale your workloads unless you are pretty sure about what you cannot scale. Right? So that's the fundamental understanding that we have to have before embarking on a scaling challenge. Now, the typical monitoring paradigms of yesterday, like your monitoring systems, your threshold based alerting, and so on and so forth, are pretty much good for knock screens or pretty much giving you the comfort level to look, there is some alerting happening. We all get a false notion that with this we are safe, right? But the actual problems to be monitored are something else, right? We need to monitor all the Fine-O-Tex errors that happen on any infrastructure. So Fine-O-Tex is an easy problem because obviously it assumes that there is certain backend capacity issues, you can fix them. Fine-O-Tex on Fine-O-Tex, these actually require a bit more effort because they are related to application timeouts and API lookups which fail and so on. So that is something that you have to monitor very closely. And these are the parameters that you have to feed into a decision engine to actually go ahead and scale. And surprisingly, the average payload times people still don't monitor it as aggressively as you should. Probably only the SEO guys monitor this rather than the DevOps guys, which is an irony in today. Right? And TTFP is still a problem. People still do inline requests, people still do synchronous lookups to your DB and so on. So if you look at any major site today, you would see that there's a fundamental time to first byte, which is a potential slow loader for you, especially on 3G networks and so on. This TTFP problem is increased manifold. Now, this is a reference architecture for a cloud agnostic environment. Again, it's a microcosm of the total architecture, so this is just a representative view. So instead of doing your load balancers on the cloud and so on, you are typically relying on ECS based HA proxies, you're doing your own CDN clusters, you are setting up your web servers with L-sync. This is typically to ensure that you do not have any single points of failure, right? So you're not relying on a storage mechanism which can act up all of a sudden. So completely single point of failure avoidance strategy over here. You have your masters, VPCs, your Mongo cluster with arbiters. So everything is completely agnostic here, which means that there is no dependency on any native services of the cloud. Now, this architecture, or similar to this architecture, is reproducible across clouds. Right? You could be on AWS, Azure, your GCP, Alibaba, Tencent, wherever you go. This architecture is exactly reproducible anywhere, which is quite not possible if you have a cloud native environment, because you will always be complaining about one single service which is not on the other cloud, and that could be a blocker in your migration plans. Right? This is not to say that you should always migrate your infrastructure, but this is to have the ability to migrate your infrastructure. Okay, now again coming back to the scaling challenge. Now that we know that the typical monitoring metrics are just that, it's very difficult. You need to concentrate on things like your Fine-O-Tex using Elasticsearch, Fine-O-Tex using Elasticsearch, and so on. Now that we know what is the parameter that you want to scale, It's also important to know what is two paradigms that you can use, so proactive and reactive. So the proactive method, or the reactive method assumes that you have enough capacity built in your infrastructure. Typically, like, let's say you build in 30 to 40% of additional capacity in your infrastructure. This is with the assumption that any immediate scaling can be done without having to break the spec, right? So this assumes like a lot of provisioning delays. For example, if you are doing some fancy hardware for your databases with custom SSDs, NVMEs, and so on. So obviously, these kind of hardware cannot be on demand. There is always like a finite latency. So even let's say 4 hours, that is still a finite latency. It's not on demand that you get. And this also assumes that you have cold cache problems. Cold cache problems are things like, so there are applications where even if you throw hundreds of servers, it will not scale because the cache has to warm up, everything has to be repopulated. So we know of enough architectures of big major sites where the entire memory cache has to be populated on a local machine before it can start serving requests. So those kind of things are there. And this is typically done for systems which are on the backend. For example, your DB masters and so on. You cannot dynamically scale your master vertically, right? So that is an obvious one. And this understanding of what cannot be scaled instantly is going to help you focus on what can be scaled very, very rapidly. So so the rapid provisioning assumes that you can get your instances or containers or whatever basic unit that you use, it can be provisioned in a very, very fast clip, right? And containers are the fastest means to do that. So you could typically have your containers up and running in a few seconds, right? Even your virtual machine for that matter, no matter what kind of clouds you use, assume a few minutes delay at any time. So typically what happens is during let's say sale periods, or like you have some activity put in at a particular period of time. By the time your scaling algorithm kicks in, it's a few minutes of delays where all the machines are provisioned and so on, the traffic meters are. Right? So you cannot react to that kind of sudden workloads. So this is so containers are the fastest way to do those rapid provisioning systems, and ideal for anyone who is on the internet doing webscale traffic, where you are doing content sites or e-commerce sites, where at the sudden mention of your handle on Twitter or something by a celebrity, your traffic would go exponential. For those kind of requirements, this is what we recommend. And anyways, you need new age data pipelines to help with your scaling decisions, right? Your services and your other old age monitoring systems is not going to help you scale that very dynamically. Now, I'd like to introduce to you to one container management platform with which we have like a lot of success in very, very rapid provisioning and dynamic scaling with. This is Rancher. It's an open source platform. So it has support for almost all orchestration frameworks. Right? So this doesn't say so-and-so container orchestration solution is better than so-and-so. All it says is like, I support everything and I give an overlay layer over all of this. And it does like service discovery networking all by itself. It does all the storage, it takes care of that. It can do like all the LBs by itself. So typically, every service has an HL proxy inbuilt in Rancher. So your load balancing at the service level is taken care of by default. So a lot of things that you have to do along with containers is actually abstracted out here as a service for metadata to query the performance of the containers. You can even restart containers if it fails to meet certain parameters and so on. So that is what it does. Again, a lot of enterprise features like your AAA integrations. You can build a catalog of your own services, etc. But overall, it provides you an integration with all sorts of. In fact, Kubernetes a lot more heavily these days. as everyone in this room might know, Kubernetes seems to be slightly edging ahead in the container management space. Okay, now, before you actually say, hey, look, I'm going to launch more instances, it's very important to know what's a good box, right? If you do not have a good box, having more boxes of the same bad box is not going to solve the problem, right? So let's say your memory requirements are about 6 GB, right? So typically, on the safer side, what you will do is overcommit and say, hey, look, I am happy with 7 GB or 8 GB for this node. Now, let's say you took a wrong decision and you went ahead with 4 GB, right? Now, what will happen is, like, the moment your 4 GB limit is crossed, your pipelines, all your firewall tools, your elastic alerts, everything will start saying that, look, this is bad, you are getting timeout requests and so on. And your orchestration solution will fire more nodes of the same config of 4 GB. So what happens is, like, it's an exponential degradation, because anytime you fill a container and put a new container in, there is a redispatching board, some more requests are lost. So a lot of things like degrades in an exponential manner. Assume always certain overcommit on a per node basis, right? Never size it to the boom, right? For example, again, I give the example of a 6 GB node again. If you have to have a 6 GB node, just go 7 GB or 8 GB, right? Because no matter what kind of provisioning systems you use, there is still a small finite latency. Let's say you got the containers up, but it is still a few seconds away. So you are better off overcoming on a per node basis and serving those requests on the same box instead of having to fire a new container to redispatch all your requests to a new container. And network planning is again super important. For example, how much throughput you have, how much IOPS can you deliver on a per box basis, because a lot of deployments these days convert your local IO into network IO, right? And with a lot of containers and so on, typically everything is modeled as a service in your microservices architecture. So the bandwidth required to handle such huge amounts of data needs to be very well planned. Otherwise, you are just converting your web scaling challenge into a network scaling challenge, right? Essentially, your compute problem becomes a network problem because you're not pushing out enough data in your nodes. So, whether you require 10G networks, whether you have sufficient IOPS, all those decisions are very important, because unless you finalize your single box by doing these decisions, no scaling algorithm is going to save. And it's very important to be humble about what cannot be scaled, right? For example, most people have problems with DB scaling. When you want to migrate to a bigger machine, there are a lot of problems with other data stores and so on. So make sure that you solve and at least understand what cannot be scaled in your network. Because don't assume that you can suddenly shard your way out of a crisis situation. You cannot. You will rewrite the problem exponentially again. You will have far more problems to solve. In fact, there are people who say, okay, no matter what happens, don't share. Right? So, make sure that you understand the limitations of your scaling. It's very easy to be managerial about this and say, okay, look, this is just another box away for us to scale. But in practice and in when the traffic hits, this is not how it works. For example, your network setups have to be absolutely right the first time. Right? DNS lookups, for example, that's a very simple example that people often make mistakes with. You cannot scale it up massively. So, for example, let's say you use a Google DNS or your own local DNS as well. If you're doing millions of requests to, let's say, a weather portal like AccuWeather, or if you're doing like a scorecard based app where you have to look up quick info a lot through an API and so on, those API requests cannot be scaled on the DNS lookups. So you have to make sure that you set up something like Unbound or any other competing open source software which can do millions of DNS lookups without any visible latency. So those kind of things have to be ensured that you're getting the network setup right, you are making sure that you know what you cannot scale. So this will ensure that you're not surprised when you have to actually go ahead and scale.
think there are like
so in the meanwhile, shoot any questions if you have in the meanwhile. I just figure out very much. Anything very quickly? Anyone has a comment or anything to share actually? And pull it up. Okay, so I wanted to actually discuss the rancher architecture. I am not sure where it gets suddenly disappeared. So essentially what will happen is like your static workloads for your DB and your workloads for your data stores, that will all be on the traditional model, your VMs and dedicated servers and so on, and your the web scaling part of it, that's going to be completely containerized, where you can essentially build a microservices and essentially launch your way out, like a massively scale anything that you want.
I'm trying to figure out, I have a question.
Okay, can you make it? So this is the bit that I was speaking about. So you will have a core network. I'm not sure if the text are too visible over here. So people typically have a low rate of change on your core network. So this is your network setup, this is your firewalls, and this is your NAT gateways and so on, where the typical you will have very low rate of change. And there is like a high cost of change because of the config of these boxes are so that you have to spend a $20 to get this up. And there is low tolerance for disruptions, right? People don't want to revert their DB schemas or DB changes anytime in the middle. But the app specific network, your APIs and the web layers and your services that you export or that you work on a daily basis, this has a very high rate of change. Right, so Pratik was going to speak next to me. So they actually have an hourly release model, right? Hasgeek has done this. So very high rate of change on a daily basis, and the cost of change is very low because if you're doing a container network, container is all expendable, so just take out anything. And there is a high tolerance of disruption as well because you're anyways doing all your A/B testing and releases all the time on this app specific network. Whereas on the core network, nothing much changes unless you are doing like a massive upgrade on your core layers, or you're increasing more bandwidth on your firewalls, or doing something like that. Okay, and again, coming back to the rancher architecture, supports everything, Kubernetes, Docker swarms, and so on. It can nicely tie into your CI/CD pipelines, Jenkins, or Bamboo, whatever it is that you want. And this essentially supports not just your local bare metal boxes, but you can also use this to orchestrate all your public clouds. I'll just give you a small example. So this is an example of a multi-cloud on Rancher. So you can see that I have my infrastructure at two places, AWS and Google. And I can also do a lot of labeling where I can say, look, this particular service, for example, big data, I can tag them and say the big data services should always be launched on Google, right? Some EMR services should always be launched on AWS. I'm just giving you an example of how you can set custom scheduling policies. Essentially, you find out houses for courses, right? Wherever is the best service that you get at the best price, you ensure that you run your workloads on that. So, Cloud Google, two nodes of Cloud AWS, look at your container distributions, one Redis here, one Postgres, and one Redis and one Postgres. So depending on how many nodes you have, you will end up being able to load balance all of them on your own. So this is a very, very simple illustrative example of one Postgres and one Redis. Of course, there is an LB which ensures that for any entry point to any of the service, you have an HR proxy load balancer. So this can do again, that's the golden standard for load balancing any traffic. Nothing comes even close to that. You can do millions of requests all the time. And this approach essentially means that the same container can be deployed in multiple places. So you don't have to essentially change the way you deploy. You don't have to change your CI/CD pipelines. This is just new additional infrastructure. So this could be on any public cloud. So which is what we are saying. Again, quickly summarizing. So if you want to be like really performance and cost oriented, make sure that you go cloud agnostic on the cloud. And if you want to exponentially scale up your web services or your app services, go for microservices approach based on containers. And you have to make sure that you understand what you cannot scale in an instant, and make sure that you sufficiently overcommit and supersize them. And this is very important. So new age metrics are needed to monitor and scale. So don't rely on the typical your Akingas or your Alexas or any of them to help you out. You need to define new age pipelines. And this is again a prediction on which we have already seen some fruition. So any web scale app of a very high traffic of app of today and tomorrow would be multi-zone and multi-cloud, right? One of the first recommendations that we have for everyone is that start running your DR on an alternate public cloud. That will expose enough challenges in your nativity strategy of your cloud to make sure that you are prepared for eventual multi-cloud deployment. So if you can run your DR on a separate public cloud, you will know of enough challenges. And essentially, like, then you can create a multi-cloud strategy where you ensure that you are able to spawn your workloads across clouds and make sure that you get the best cost performance ratios over here. Alright, I'm done. Thanks a lot. So any feedback, questions, I'll appreciate it.